So, good morning. I'm finally leaving Chile to Ruta 40 in Argentina, the famous Ruta 40. And I'm coming up to the Chilean border now, where I'll have to exit. So I'll go to immigration, get my stamp out, then I'll go to aduana and get my import permit thrown out. So hopefully there's no bus in front of me, which always means trouble. Hopefully someone will tell me what to do here too. Hopefully I'll just park right out the front. Right here.
Hi guys, and welcome again to another video. This is on the Argentinian side. So just talking about border crossings, all your paperwork, registration, your title. If you don't have your title, if you don't own the vehicle, so, like I own the vehicle, so my name's on the title. If you've got like a finance company on the title, you've got to get a letter from them saying it's fine for you to travel with your bike. So you got your registration, your originals of your registration, your title, your passport, and your international driver's license, even though I never got asked for my international driver's license. And then what you want to have is and your driver's license. Then you want to have copies of each one of those. I had 10 of them in one of my bags, and I kept a couple of my backpacks. Get a really good waterproof satchel for all your originals, because you have to pull them out quite a lot. During the trip, at each border crossing, you've got to show your originals, and a lot of the times they'll ask for copies. Some border crossings, they'll give you the documents, then you've got to go get a copy of the documents. This was quite simple, a process. I was in and out of there in probably 10 to 15 minutes. Each border crossing is different. Some of them are understaffed and overpopulated with people trying to get in, and some of them, like this, you know, had like one or two people in there. So it's just a matter of planning. The best time to go is always early in the morning, and obviously not weekends if you can help it. Doing it in early mornings. Tuesdays and Thursdays are usually Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursdays are normally the slowest days. And so they're the best days to do it. It's a process, and you've just got to get in your head, and I've said this on all the previous border crossing videos, get in the head that it might be 2 to 3 hours. And if anything less than that, it's a bonus. These sort of remote border crossings are always a lot better, you know, but some of the countries only have one or two border crossings, and they're fairly main entry points, so there's a lot of traffic. On a motorbike, you can normally ride right up the front. If there's a big line of cars, don't be shy, just ride up the front. The worst thing they're going to do is tell you to go to the back of the line. It never happened to me once. I was able to go pretty much to the front at any time, and just park my bike and then go in there. Normally they'll wave you through to park your bike. Just make sure you get into you understand the process each time. Going out of the country, you go to immigration first, and then you go and do your aduana, your hand in your bike permit. If you're required to have a tourist card, you'll probably have to hand that in when you leave the country as well. The fees are always pretty reasonable. However, coming into Argentina, you have to get your tourist visa from me in Australia and the US beforehand. You can't get it at the border, so you've got to go. You can register it, you can go online. If you have a look at my blog post, it'll have the link to where you go to get your tourist visa. The US also have a reciprocity fee, of $160. My tourist visa for 90 days or 150 days or whatever I got it for was like $100, which is expensive, but it's what they charge. You know, it's usually countries do unto them or what others do unto them. So, but so if the if Australia has a $100 fee for the Argentina, then Argentina will slap a $100 fee on Australia. It's a bit of a tit for tat type thing. But just really keep your original documents and always treat them with kid gloves, because you're going to use them on a long trip like this. You're going to use them 50, 60 times, and you don't want to get any tears in them. Any excuse for somebody who's a pain in the backside to make your life miserable, you want to rule all those things out. As an example, on the Honduras-El Salvador border, the border customs people tore a part of my main page of my passport. Just the top corner, when they put it through the machine, it just tore like about 5 millimeters of a tear. And that caused me all sorts of problems because they'd say that it's tampered with. So that was a freaking pain in the backside for me. So, you know, a lot of them didn't bother about it, but about three or four border crossings, they ended up getting an extra person in to look at it and then asking me about, you know, and then me providing more. And I had copies of everything. So have all your originals in a waterproof bag. So because you want to have it at the ready. When you get to a border, you want to have all your stuff just in one satchel. So I have a waterproof satchel for all my originals, and then I have all my copies in the second satchel. Because in most border crossings, you're going to need copies of all your documents. Your passport, photo page, your driver's license, your registration and your title. And if you don't own your vehicle, you have to have a letter from the company on the title, the finance company or whatever. I owned my vehicle, so it's on the title. And different border crossings have different rules. You can read up on them on my site about all the things you're going to need at each border crossing and the cost involved of each border crossing. Sometimes it's smart. I've been to Argentina before, so I actually had a fair bit of Argentinian cash on me anyway, but it's smart. A lot of the border crossings will have money changers. This one didn't. So you can exchange money, have enough money to get something to eat and for a tank of fuel in the new currency if you can get it. So about $50 worth of money as you enter a country. Usually you can get it even at the border town before you can get the next country's currency. You just need an extra day to go around and do it. Sometimes you can't, but just make sure in the countries where you can't get any cash, make sure you've got a full tank of fuel, because some of the countries, it might be 200 miles before you get to the first gas station. Some of them are right near the border, you know. So it's just about being planning everything and being smart. And, you know, there's one thing that I would like to see happen, because I think that if you're traveling, you know, maybe getting an organization together to get an international bike permit. So basically, and then trying to get the countries involved to actually, if you go through this international permit thing and each country has its own thing and there's a fee that you pay, maybe like $500 or $1,000 or something like that, and then that gets you a free, just like your stamp into immigration, you also hand in your permit, and it just gets processed really quickly rather than having to go through all the rigmarole. On this trip, as an example, maybe 20 border crossings, 25 border crossings. You know, if you look at that at an average of 2 hours of border crossing, that's two full days you'd save, you know. But anyway, it's just something that should happen. I mean, most of the systems are now computerized. They can handle passports. Just getting that additional thing added to the system where you have an international vehicle permit with that basic, and then you just have a computer system and then all the countries sign up to it, and it just makes the processing a lot better. It's better for the countries. I would have happily paid $1,000 to get an international bike permit to get into all countries rather than having to go through the import and export of the permits. But, you know, it'll be a long process, but it'll be well worth it. Okay, so the ride today, you know, it was a pretty boring sort of ride. once I got to once I got through both borders, and it took, you know, it was about I think in total I had about 6 hours of riding to do and about 430 kilometers to ride. So it was a pretty easy ride day. Just took my time. I stopped three or four times. I was going to a city called Gobernador Jesus, so hard to pronounce. Gobernador Gregores. Gobernador Gregores. Which is a pretty nice little town. But it was probably the windiest place I've ever seen in my life. I was there for two nights. And it seriously had... it's seriously, the wind was just blowing a gale both days I was there, and all the trees were bent over. But I stayed at a pretty nice little place, so probably a really good place for bikers, because you can ride your bike right at the back of the driveway and right next to the inside the building. So it was pretty cool, and it was reasonably cheap, like $50 a night. It's in the middle of nowhere, and the city really doesn't have that much going for it. So the ride today was not, you know, basically you're inland, so you're a fair, on the right hand side is the Andes, and they're a fair way away. So it was a pretty uneventful riding day. So the idea was to spend a couple of nights there and just get my bearings and then plan all my road. I spent pretty much a full day planning all the next few days riding and where I was going to go, and it was El Calafate, which is basically the city it's like a gateway to all the big glaciers and stuff like that. So I was pretty excited about it. It was pretty warm inland, but very windy. And the Gobernador Gregores has a gas station there. A little bit of a queue each time to get gas, and you'll find that when you get to Argentina, that's going to be one of your big issues, is gas stations. Not only gas stations with long queues, but gas stations that don't have any gas. So do some research online, try to find out if a town's got two or three gas stations, you're going to get pretty lucky. But a couple of guys that I met along the way ended up having to stay an extra night somewhere because there was no gas in the gas station. And, you know, Argentina is pretty renowned for strikes and stuff like that. And this is the only country where I actually ran out of gas, because there's some big... If you've got a bike that gets you less than, say, 400 kilometres, 250 miles, then you're going to need an extra gas tank on the back. I've got a 1 gallon there, but even with that, one of the places the gas stations were closed, didn't have any gas, so I had to keep going, and I didn't make it by about four. I was about two or three, maybe 4 miles out of the city when I completely ran dry, and I was really spewing about it too, because I could actually see the town, and I knew that I was on empty for like 30 miles. And I knew that I was in big trouble, within a minute somebody came. I parked my bike down in a ditch so you couldn't see it from the road, and a guy came and gave me a lift to the gas station. I filled up my 1 gallon tank, put it in the bike, just turned the bike on, let it bleed into it, and then within 30 seconds the bike was started up, went to the gas station, filled up. And I was on my way. But there was probably two or three times in my Argentinian trip where I got really, really low on gas, and just made it. So Argentina's fantastic. There's a few ride days, three or four more days of riding off-road, and some of the roads are pretty bad. But I had a great day's riding today. Really simple, and no issues with pretty much anything. But anytime, you've just got to get into a habit of anytime if you go past a gas station, even if you've got 3/4 of a tank, just go in there and fill it up. It just makes it life so much easier. Then the other thing, thinking, oh well, the next town's 200 kilometres away, and then you get to the next town and there's no gas in the gas stations. And the gas prices are pretty much all the same as the US in Argentina. They're all government owned. All the gas stations, I'm pretty sure, they're owned by only one or two countries. And always get the premium gas if you can, because I also had one tank where it cost me 2 to 3 hours because I had to actually take my bike apart and bleed all the gas from it because I got a really bad mix on one of the gas stations, and the bike wouldn't go above 20 to 30 mile an hour. It just couldn't handle. The fuel pump was just having failures everywhere, and so you just got to be careful. I think it's YPF, something like that, is the gas station name that I stuck with. There's a few other different brands here and there, but I had some problems with them. But you'll find all the major towns have gas stations. Some of the smaller towns have them, but they might be out of gas. So you just got to be really smart, and just be taking your time and filling up whenever you can fill up, and just use that as a bit of a break time. But even though it's desolate, it's quite pretty in its own right. This is the one of the gas stations, YPF, that's it, yeah. This is a little sort of oasis in the middle of nowhere. It's pretty cool. So anyway, guys, same as before, any questions or comments, some really cool ride days coming up, just leave them below.